Hello everyone, welcome to the series finale of the Lee Valley Outdoor Games live streams. So my name is Matt, I'm an Ottawa-based woodworker, and today I'm going to go through the steps to help you build a ring toss game for your backyard. So a lot of the games have the board that you're going to build, a lot of the games kind of have a surfboard looking feel to them. So what I did here was I just made a simple little glue up using three pieces of wood. You want to make sure that you are using wood that is that would be great for being outside. So anyways, I'll go through everything. So we're using cedar, mahogany, and another piece of cedar. So before I really get into everything, let's see if where everyone's logging in from, and we'll chat for a couple minutes and just to get things going, and we'll go from there. But it is a great game for the backyard, and it's something that anyone can build. You don't need a lot of tools, and you don't need a lot of experience or anything like that. So we'll just watch for a second and see where people are logging in from, and then we'll get started. And if feel free to ask questions throughout the live stream, and if we can't get to your questions right away or anything like that, feel free to follow back to the feed or the video, and we'll answer questions there as well. So I guess we'll get started. So like I was saying, so I glued up three pieces of wood. The reason why I'm using cedar, I'm using eastern white cedar, actually offcuts from the planter box that we did the video for before. I'm using a piece of mahogany for the stringer and another piece of cedar. So I've got some rough pieces of cedar here. When you do a glue up, you actually want to make sure that we alternate the grain. So you can see there's kind of a happy face and a frown. So I'm going to sit those here into the clamps. And I also have another stringer. Hello, Chip. That's amazing that you're logging in from North Carolina. I hope you're having a fabulous Friday and looking forward to the weekend. And Bill in Mississippi, that's amazing. I'm always blown away when people, where we get to see everyone's logging in from. So if you're just tuning in, I'm using cedar, and this actually is just an offcut of walnut that I did have lying around. And here's the finished product that we're going to be working towards. So I've got my two pieces here in the clamps. You can use any glue that's rated for outdoor use. What I'll do is I'll just put, actually, what I'll do on these boards here. So I'm just going to put a bead down the center. I'll just use my finger to smooth it out. And don't worry about any kind of glue squeezing out from the top or the bottom or anything like that. We would take care of that during the sanding process. And like I was saying before, do ask any questions that you might have. And it's a fun, easy project. It's great with kids, and it's an even funner game for the backyard. So this one here, I'll show you when we get to that stage where we'll end up mounting it to the side of the house, and it's ready for hours of fun. So welcome, Sean from Victoria. I hope everything's going well out west. Such a beautiful city. So you can see I've glued the two inner edges for both pieces of cedar. And then I have a third piece that is just a piece of walnut that I'm going to use on the inside here. So I'll just rub those together to get some glue on the face. Mary from Massachusetts, that's amazing. Such a beautiful place, beautiful state. So I'm gently clamping these guys. You can see a little bit of squeeze out there. What I like to do is just kind of wipe off as much of the glue as possible. Once the glue hardens, it's hard on your planer knives. It's hard to sand through. So I just try to remove as much of that as possible. When I do glue ups, I always make sure that I tend to leave the piece in the clamps for overnight. So generally I do most of my glue ups in the afternoon, leave them overnight, then continue to work on them in the morning, the following morning, I should say. One thing when you're clamping, you want to make sure that you don't put too much pressure. So every time I go to use a clamp, I always make sure that the handle is backed off all the way to the throat, I should say, of the clamp, and then just brush them together and then tighten it up. You'll actually lose, maybe not. You'll lose pressure if the throat on the clamp is already extended as you try to tighten it. So just make sure it's nice and snug. You don't need to over tighten clamps. Just a nice tight fit. Anything over tightening can actually starve the joint, and you'll actually remove the glue from the piece. So we will let that sit, you know, through the magic of the internet and TV and everything. We have this guy here ready. So we'd let that sit. After I did that, what I did was I have a template for these here. These are actually started off, they're slightly different. It's a hand plane for surfing, for body surfing. And so I do make quite a few of those. So that's why I'm going with this general shape. It's a little smaller than what I would actually use for surfing. But so it's the shape that I wanted to go for. Doesn't have to be a surfboard shape or anything like that. It could just be a rectangle. It could be a square. It could be anything you want. So what I've done is I've shaped it into the shape that I wanted. I've also gone down and just gently broken the edges on the shape as well. So I used a bandsaw to cut this out, but you could actually use a jigsaw. You could use a scroll saw. There's lots of different ways to do it. You don't need any kind of fancy tools. You could actually use a coping saw or anything like that as well. So there's no issues with not having to have a big fancy bandsaw to make this. So next step, I did drill three holes, because what we want to do is this will actually, we'll put this in after, but this would screw into the center of it. And the other two holes are for mounting onto the wall of your house. So anytime I'm doing anything with holes like that where mounting, I always want to make sure that I'm using a countersink bit just to make the holes as clean as possible. So just bear with me for 1 second. So I'm just going to, I'm just going to break the top of them. Maybe. Of course, that doesn't want to work right now, so bear with me for 1 second. I do have another one here. So I'm just breaking, like I said, the edges of that hole, so that when we add the screws and put the anchors in the wall, the exterior wall of the house, it'll just have a nice cleaner look to it. There we go. So I'm not too sure if you're able to see that, but it just gives a much nicer look to the hole. And actually the head of the screw will countersink down into the wood. Being that this is outside for outside use, you would want to make sure you're either using brass hardware, stainless hardware, or like a decking screw or anything like that you're attaching to the wall, because those won't rust. Anything else will rust, and then you're going to have to replace it every so often. So the other thing that I do for any sort of outdoor piece, and all the games that we've been doing before, I finish it with a mix of both turpentine and linseed oil. So that's what I'm going to do here today. That's exactly it, Sean. I actually tightened the countersink before we started, and of course it wanted to loosen for some reason. So linseed oil and turpentine are, like I said, it's a mix for finish that I use quite often. Anything that I build that goes outside, you could use a water-based polyurethane. You could use, a verathanes. You could use a marine spar, anything like that. What I do is I tend to brush it on first. And then what I'll do is after a few minutes, I'll actually wipe it off. You don't want to let linseed oil actually get, You don't want to leave it on. It will soak in, but you'll actually want to remove the excess, because if you don't, it will definitely be very, very sticky, and it'll be a pain to clean up and sand after. So I always brush it on. Make sure you get quite a bit of finish on the end grain towards the ends. What happens is that's where most of the water will actually soak in. What happens with cedar and pine and oak and any of those woods, if they get water damage, they just go black. So you will have issues with that if you don't seal it properly. Sean, you could use eco epoxy. That would definitely work. I tend not to use a whole lot of epoxy in the stuff that I build, but eco epoxy would be great as long as it has UV inhibitors in it, because you'd want to make sure that it's going to stand up to the sunlight. I know people often even ask me, you know, could I build something out of walnut or maple or anything like that to be used outside? And there's specific woods that the sun will just damage too much. So you might have a better chance if you did coat it with something like eco epoxy and put it outside. But I couldn't guarantee it without knowing that it does have quite a bit of UV inhibitors. So what I do with the finish is I always wipe it on, let it sit for 10, 15 minutes, wipe off the excess, flip it, do the other side. And I usually try to get 2 to 3 coats a day. When I'm making one of these for surfing or a big surfboard or anything like that, you want to make sure that you would have, I usually have about 10 to maybe 15 coats of finish on it, because what that does is, you know, you get out in the water and it just beads up on it. It's a natural finish. I start off using kind of a mix of 50-50 turpentine and linseed oil, and actually as I get to the final coats, I remove, I start using less of the turpentine, so more of just a pure linseed oil mix. So what I'll do is I'll just wipe that down, but you can actually see how nice it starts to look with the finish on it. So maybe I'll flip it and do the other side before I wipe that down. Yeah, you definitely, anything outside, you want to make sure if you're using any kind of fancy product, you would definitely want to check to make sure that it does have a good amount of UV inhibitors, just because it tends to be the sun that will break down most finishes. I have seen indoor finishes that were used on outdoor jobs, and I've actually seen where the sun has made them crackle, just because it didn't have the UV inhibitors that it would actually need. And you want this to last. And anything you put outside, whether it's an outdoor coffee table or a patio table or anything like that, you want to make sure that it's going to last quite a long time. So the more coats of oil and finish that you can put on something, the better. A rattle can is great. What I usually try to do is, because it does give you a super nice finish, what I will do is I'll actually start with brushing anyways. And then go from there. Usually I'll brush on, even if we're doing, like, if it's outdoor poly or anything like that, we'll brush on a few coats. Anything that kind of builds up a finish, like, you know, like you were saying, like the epoxy or even varathane or polyurethane or anything like that, will sand in between coats. Might only sand with maybe a 220 or starting from there. Flatten all the dust nibs, and then you could actually spray your last couple coats. But I do like to make sure that I have a heavy enough coat to start that the rattle can, because I think generally when you're spraying finish, I want to say a typical amount that you want to spray is up to about 6 mils. And I think that a rattle can provides, I think it's maybe 1.5. So you're not getting too much coverage out of it. So you'd want to make sure that you would want to do lots and lots of coats with it. I know that varathane does actually make a really nice oil-based spray finish that's a fast drying, and it looks really, really nice. A lot of people will do something like this where they'll actually use linseed oil, get a few coats on it to help bring up the depth of the grain, and from there, then they'll actually finish it with a spray can or anything that you want on top. You want to make sure that whatever finish you are using, if you're putting something else different, you're putting something else on top of something you've already started, you want to make sure that it's compatible or very well dried. So oil on oil is always fine, but you can never put water base on top of oil without using something like a seal coat or like a shellac or something like that in between. Like a seal coat just allows you to actually seal off what's underneath, and then you can build something up on top of it. So we have one coat down. So like I said, I would let this sit back at the shop. I'd have stickers that I'd put on the bench, let it sit, let it get air around it. Maybe an hour or so, I'd walk by it again, give it a wipe just in case you start to see any kind of wet pooling spots or anything like that. This looks pretty good. So then I would do another coat, you know, maybe another 2-3 coats throughout the day. We don't have that luxury. So this one here, I'm going to go ahead and do some of the other portions to it, let's say. So you can actually buy these hooks here at Lee Valley. So you can get ones that have the round over. I don't know if that's the proper term for these hooks, but it actually finishes up a little bit further. I like these guys here because it actually allows you to throw the ring onto it, and it's a lot easier to do so. So I've pre-drilled a hole, and I just based the hole on just slightly smaller than the width of the screw. So I'm going to screw that in. And this hook is also out for outdoor use, and you can find it on the website. So there we have that portion so far. So what we will do the next thing we would do is actually drill, you know, if it's into wood on the side of your house or on a shed or whatever it might be, you would have a couple holes. If you need to put anchors, if it's going into masonry or anything like that, pre-drill your holes, use a screw, and just drill into the board. The holes have been countersunk, so you get a nice finished look to it, and you'd be ready to go with that part. Like I was saying before, anything outside you'd want to use stainless hardware, brass hardware, or even just a decking screw or anything like that, just allow you to, to allow it, to survive in our environment. If you live in a place that's nice and warm and sunny, like I can see Scott's logging in from Texas, that's pretty amazing. You could probably get away with some of the different screws. The next portion here is. This also mounts to your house. So this guy here, I'll give you, and actually we do have templates that will be available for this. So this guy here is roughly 11 inches wide by 11 inches long by 6 3/4 wide. Now this next block of wood is 6 3/4 by 3 1/4. And it's also 1 1/4 thick. So this piece here is what we would actually mount to the house as well. So I'm going to just break the edges. So I've already done a little bit of sanding on it at the shop. I just like to break the edges on everything so that when you're touching it, it's not you're not going to get slivers and it's not going to cut your hand. This piece here of wood is actually ash. So ash is another wood that you can use outside without being worried about it rotting or anything like that. It's a very durable wood, and it's very plentiful because of the issues with the ash borer. So I can see a couple pencil lines from when I was drilling my holes. So that's almost ready. So I'm going to do the same sort of thing where I'm going to countersink just a couple of these holes. There's one. So, and like I was saying, I like to do that just because it gives you a cleaner finish. So if you have an orbital, you can definitely use an orbital for that. Same sort of thing. What I'd want to do is just pre-finish. I'm going to try not to get the finish down into the main hole in the center there, because that's actually what's going to attach the dowel that allows the rope to, or the string to hang off the wall that you'll actually use to throw into the game. So like I was saying, you definitely want to make sure that you seal up that end grain. End grain is like a sponge, and it will just soak up any kind of moisture and water from outside, which we don't, we don't want. We want this to last quite a while on the side of your house or wherever you're going to put it. You could play it inside too if you wanted, actually. That'd be fun. Winter's about to come for us, so maybe this is something that we could put inside. So, I'm just going to wipe a little bit of that off because it's a little thick, but I'll let that dry. So, the other thing that we have to do is, with the game, you have, so this will be mounted on the wall. So I'm going to take some glue here. And what I've done is I've pre-drilled a hole here, and the hole is at 11 degrees into the block of wood. So I have a jig at the shop that allows me to set my drill press to a specific angle. So this is 12 degrees, I think it is. So the dowel here was also is also from Lee Valley, so I picked that up last week. So that allows me to sink that into the piece of wood. So this would actually sit like this on your wall. The arm extends out, or the dowel extends out, and then that's what we would use to attach the rope. So I'm going to put a little bit of finish on this dowel as well. And then I would let that dry. If I wanted, I could actually let that glue and then do the finish as well. But I just wanted to show you guys kind of the process to do so. Like I was saying, I always let stuff glue or dry for, you know, overnight. So, you know, usually 12, 14, 16 hours. I think a lot of glue manufacturers will tell you that you can actually take the piece out of the clamps after 35 or 45 minutes. That seems to be a bit of a rush for me. I tend to want to make sure that it's nice and solid. So I would definitely wait longer than that. But like I said, the manufacturers will tell you. I've just always kind of let them sit overnight. I tend not to want to rush anything like that. So that's almost, so I'll just let that sit. Like I was saying, when I start with boiled linseed oil, I always have a mix of, and just seal the end grain up there as well. I always have a mix I start off with about 50 to 50. And then what I do is, as I get more and more coats onto the piece, the mixture changes. So this is a mix that we always have at the shop that's a heavy mix of more leaning on the heavier side for the linseed oil. But you just want to make sure that you remove any excess, because what happens is linseed oil or any kind of natural oil like that will get really gummy, and then you'll have issues with it never really wanting to dry. And that's no fun, because then you can't play with your ring toss game. So I'm just going to give that a wipe. Wipe off any excess glue down there. And then we would let that sit. And then, like I said, I would let that sit in there tomorrow. And then another few coats on it, and it would be ready to go. So on the end of the piece of dowel here, I actually ended up drilling a little hole in it. So I'm going to put that over here and make sure that is centered. I'm just going to do a little bit of sealing of the end grain there. I can see that's right there. Just give that a little bit of a wipe. If you happen to have any questions while I'm doing this, please feel free to hop on there and ask a question. So for the rope, I'm using some jute that I picked up. I'm going to go with long enough piece that you want to have a long enough piece of string or rope or jute or anything you want to use so that you can stand maybe 5-6 feet back so that you can actually toss the ring towards the hook in your board there. So this is, it's about 6 feet. I'm about 6 feet. I think this is actually, it's longer, so that's fine. So what I would do is just tie it. I put the hole there so I can actually tie a knot. So you could do a couple different things. You could actually I'm gonna do is tie a knot down here. So I've looped it through, pulled it through to one side. I just want to make sure that there's going to be, that's going to be there. Maybe I'll do one over the top just to get a little fancy. There's no need to, you don't have to get fancy with these. I happen to have this wood and the shape lying around for the boards that I do make. Sean, that'd be a great idea. You could definitely use fishing line, which would, I would assume, last quite a while, actually. I think that this year was the first time I've changed the fishing line on my rod and reel in probably 15 years. So I don't know if that makes me a bad fisherman or what, but yeah, you could definitely use fishing line. That would be no issue. So I've tied the string on the end. So all I did was I had a hole drilled in the dowel. So I looped it back over, tied a knot, looped it over again, and then just tied another knot just so it's nice and secure. And then here's the ring that I have. So this is actually, it's called a machining, what do you call it? A machining washer, or there's a funny name for it. But the reason why I went with it over anything else is the size of it. This was just found at a local hardware store that deals with tons of different types of bolts and screws and hardware and all that stuff. So that's why I decided to use this based on the size. So if I can quickly tie a knot here. So you just want to make sure that this is good and snug. So what I'll do is I've just looped it through. I'm going to loop it through a couple more times. And then we're nearing the completion of our ring toss game. And the only other thing to do is just to have fun with it. And maybe get some more finish on it, to be honest. But that can always be done back at the shop. So what you can do is, I have seen other people with the ring toss game that we have at our house. We actually have one where the string just hangs down on the side of the wall. Loops back to the side of the wall and is sitting on another hook like that as well. You can tie it back to this. It just depends on how much rope or string that you're using. So there. So I've got few good knots in there. That should be nice and stable. I will just cut off the excess. There we go. So what, like I was saying, you'd want to do is mount this on your wall. You can use a longer dowel if you want. 3 feet, you know, is borderline close to what we have now. I think ours is actually it's a little bit longer, about 40 inches or so. The angle was just up enough so that it's keeping it away from people. So if you're walking by the wall, you're not going to get bumped into it or anything like that. And it's also, I want to say ours is set at, so I'm just under 6 feet. So it's just, it might be about 80 inches or so. And then with the angle up, and the ring would be thrown at a distance and catches on there. So it's a fun game. It's easy to make. It is, Sean. So it is quite a heavy, you wouldn't have any issues finding them. Home Depot, lots of big box places like that will sell these. This is just, it's a double thick washer, but they did call it a machining washer. But I know that Home Depot does carry these. A lot of them are called fender washers. So the bigger washers that you get tend to be called fender washers. And it sounds silly, but I also like this one just because of the color. So it's darker. It's got like an oil rubbed finish on it. I just thought it looked pretty fancy. So yeah. So anyways, like I said, you'd have both of your pieces mounted on the wall, the bracket holding the dowel off with the string, have your surfboard or your whatever shape. It could be a circle, it could be a square. It doesn't have to be a surfboard by any means. Stand back at about 6 feet or so, and You can toss that right up onto it. So it's a lot of fun. It's a quite a simple game to make. You don't need a whole lot of tools in order to make it. And you can see I've got, there we go, just some finish from the washer. But it's by no means hard. Best thing is just to let your piece glue up, cut it out in any shape you want. From there, you just want to make sure you use an outdoor finish and mount it to your wall. Make sure that you do use correct hardware to mount it to your house, just so that you're not going to damage the brick or the mortar or anything like that, or wood or whatever you're attaching it to. And yeah, so it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun to play. Sean, you're very welcome. That's great. Thanks for signing in today. If you do happen to have any questions, anyone, feel free to ask on the board or the comment section, I should say, and we'll get back to you. And like I said, a lot of these parts here are available right at Lee Valley. And yeah, it's a fantastic game, lots of fun. If you happen to have any other questions, you can always reach out to us at socials@leevalley.com. And I hope you've enjoyed this final session of the Outdoor Games live streams with Lee Valley. And we'll see you guys soon. I know we have lots more videos coming up. So like I said, socials@leevalley.com. And have a wonderful weekend, everyone. Take care.